reading today from 1 Kings, chapter 19, verses 1 through 18. It's the story of when Elijah flees to Horeb. Now Ahab told Jezebel everything Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, "May the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like that of one of them." Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there, while he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. He came to a broom brush, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. "I have had enough, Lord," he said. "Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors." Then he lay down under the bush and fell asleep. All at once an angel touched him and said, "Get up and eat." He looked around, and nearby his head was some bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, "Get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you." So he got up and ate and drank. Strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Perez, the mountain of God. There he went into a cave and spent the night. The Lord appeared to Elijah, and the word of the Lord came to him. "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And he replied, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too." The Lord said, "Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the earth was not in it. The Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to the sword, death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me." The Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came and go to the desert of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael king over Aram. Also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel, and anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Mahola, to succeed you as prophet. Jehu will put to death any who escape the sword of Hazael, and Elisha will put to death any who escape the sword of Jehu. Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all those whose knees have not bowed down to Baal and whose mouths have not kissed him."
This is the word of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Father, this morning, O Lord, I ask that you will add a blessing to the hearing, proclamation, and pondering on of your word. We ask that you will speak to us this morning because we, your servant, are ready to listen to your voice, to receive your full counsel, to embrace the word that gives us light and is light to our path and also to our feet. May the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our Lord and Redeemer. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. I still remember a phrase that Coach Orta used to say to our team when we were buying. Usually when we were buying and we were down in the count, people could hear the coach exclaiming from the dugout, "You are down But that doesn't mean you are out. You know, for people like me who were learning how to play baseball, Coach Orta's exclamation was a good reminder that an unfavorable count didn't have to result in an unfavorable outcome. The coach's shout was a good reminder to not give up hope too soon. That all I needed to do was to focus and get ready to hit the next ball in the strike zone. You are down, but that doesn't mean you are out. I know life is not a baseball game. Still, there are times when we are down for the count. We all know what it feels to be in that uncomfortable situation where you either refocus or lose hope. We all know that life is not all sunshine and rainbows. There are plenty of awful things happening in the world which affect us. We are not immune to difficult situations and the pain they cause. There are circumstances that crack our hearts open and contrite our spirits. You know, lately I've been thinking about the difficulties I have seen people endure. I have seen people dealing with unexpected losses. The loss of loved ones because of death, separation. I have seen people dealing with the loss of jobs, houses, finances. I have seen people losing their health and their physical abilities in just a matter of weeks. I have seen individuals losing confidence in themselves and becoming hermits after being the target of really mean people. There is a lot going on in the world. You know, one of these people that I have seen going down is presented to us in the text we read this morning. Elijah, the great prophet, is one of those individuals that transition from confidence to despair in a split of a second. He had become the target of a powerful, mean woman, and despite all the success he had experienced, these positive events that marked his life up to this moment were not enough to keep him thriving. In the scripture reading for this morning, we find not a resolute prophet, but a tired, weak, troubled, and fearful human being. And from the text, we learn that Elijah was down in the count at least one in his lifetime. And due to the adversity he was facing, the prophet opted to go into the wilderness. Now, when we look at the text, at first sight, it seems that Elijah was giving up hope. His prayer, "I've had enough, take my life," may lead us to think that he didn't want to live anymore. Yet, we need to remember that Elijah was running for his life. The prophet wanted to live, indeed, perhaps not the kind of life he was living, but a different kind of life. You know, I've seen people running for their lives, running the wilderness of chasing money, status, and possession. I've seen people running from alcohol to drugs to multiple unrestrained relationships. People running and chasing the wind. People not finding fulfillment, but finding themselves at the verge of giving up. Praying Elijah's prayer, "I've had enough, take my life." But in light of Elijah's story, I learned that these individuals don't really want to give up. Upon a closer study of the text, I have concluded that more than death, Elijah was praying for peace and a renewed sense of purpose. And I believe that people in the world is looking for that, even when they are not searching in the right places. The prophet was looking for peace and a renewed sense of purpose. However, his actions were not translated into healthy practices. The prophet's avoiding, escaping, and running away was resulting in wallowing and self-pity. But God gave a little tweak to Elijah's action and turned the avoiding and running away into a spiritual retreat to bring the prophet to the next level. I don't know you, but I love this picture because once again, the Bible is reminding us that God can and will turn our well-intentioned missteps into constructive and useful experiences to bring us up and out of difficult situations. God will use our missteps in a way that He will rejuvenate our minds, hearts, souls, and spirits. And let me tell you something. For me, that is great news. The Lord corrects and minimizes the gap that many times exists between our good intentions and their applications. This was the case of Elijah, who wanted to experience a different kind of life, but the way he went about it was not helpful. But let me tell you something else. God not only corrects the ill effects of good intentions, the Lord also corrects premeditated, calculated, intentional harm. Let me tell you, I find this to be even more amazing. God can and will turn evil into good. God is in the business of transforming. You may remember the life of Joseph. Joseph's life is a clear illustration of God's amazing transformative power. Joseph went from forsaken to front runner. And about 20 years after his brother had sold him as a slave, Joseph spoke before his family of the transformational power of God using these words: "You meant it. Sorry. You meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring about that many people should be kept alive as they are today." Isn't that great news, church? God transformed well-intentioned missteps as well as calculated destructive actions into good. Certainly, Elijah was down, but he was not out. God was tweaking Elijah's action to bring relief, to bring peace, and a renewed sense of purpose. Whether Elijah received it or not, the Lord was sustaining him. Up in the mountain, down in the wilderness, in the confinement of the cave, God was with Elijah. The presence of God was with Elijah in his running away, his laying down, and his hiding out. God was with Elijah, and in the same way, God is with us.
Amen.
The psalmist wrote, "You are familiar with all my ways. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there." Church, God is everywhere, surrounding, comforting us with his presence. There is nothing that can contain God's presence from reaching us. Elijah was down in the camp, but God was about to transform his situation because he was not out. True, there are many times when we cannot receive God's presence. And this happens for several reasons. For instance, the deafening presence of physical needs. Elijah was worn out, and part of the process of bringing him to a healthier place required him to eat and rest. God provided a place of rest and fed Elijah to strengthen him and help him recognize God's presence. And what I see here is God honoring our basic material needs because our spirituality is closely connected to our corporal experience and well-being. You heard the scripture reading this morning and how the angel gave the command to Elijah and said, "Get up and eat." And let me tell you something. I love that command. Just this week,
My wife asked me, in kind of a mean way, "Are you eating again?" And my answer was, "Honey, I'm sorry, but I'm obeying the word that God just gave me. Get up and eat."
Amen.
Amen. Elijah was down. Perhaps he couldn't see the presence of God because of his physical needs. But there is more. Another reason why many times we miss God's presence in our lives is because of our own expectations. Some scholars say that part of Elijah, he was creating a compulsive habit for experiencing God's presence in a spectacular, supernatural ways. Fire coming down from heaven, torrential rains, great droughts, you name it. And that's perhaps the main reason why the prophet went to Horeb, to the mountain where God had talked to Moses face to face and had revealed to the people of Israel with extraordinary demonstrations of power. Probably Elijah was looking for a spectacular experience. Let me tell you something, dear friends. Part of the lesson to Elijah and to us this morning is that God is also revealed in gentle ways. God not only revealed himself in the supernatural, but also through the natural. In the midst of the deafening silence of painful experiences, among shouts of joy, in the summit of the mountain, as well as in the deep of the valley, God is with us, revealing God's self to us. Through the loving presence, the unreserved generosity, through the wisdom, admonishment, and kindness of God's creation, God reveals to us. When you are down and you may not be feeling the presence of God, I want you to check something. Make sure that you are not expecting God to show up in a certain way, because you may be missing the presence of God.
Amen.
Next time you doubt God's company in your life, ask yourself, am I expecting God to be manifested in a specific way, or am I open to see God's goodness and power being manifested in my life in new, surprising ways? Elijah had needs, God provided for those needs. Elijah had expectations that were challenged that day, but God revealed to him. And there is an interesting detail in this passage. Elijah had to remain attentive to perceive the passing by of the Lord. And from the reading, one can infer that Elijah was not only watchful, but also silent before the presence of the Lord. Otherwise, he would have not been able to hear God's gentle whisper. And here is something that I want to share with you and I want you to learn this morning. We need to learn how to be silent in the presence of the Lord. Many times we stand before the presence of God with our arguments and complaints. Many times we master the art of talking, but we need to learn to be still and listen to the voice of God. In prayer, we need to listen more than we speak. And this is a biblical principle. God told Moses, "Be still and see God's salvation." Many times the prophets told the people to be still before the presence of the Lord. 2 weeks ago, the children reminded us, when the psalmist wrote, "Be still and know that I am," and was watchful and listening for the presence of God. And I love the fact that God whispered to Elijah, because it gives us the idea that God was really close. It makes me think of the times I have held my children in my arms and I have whispered to their ears words of consolation and to reassure them and let them know how much I care. So for me, it's not hard to imagine God holding Elijah against his chest and saying to him, "What are you doing here, big crying baby? Man up. Put your manly pants on because there is work for you to do. What are you doing here, Elijah? I have called you and you are down in the count, but let me tell you, you are not out yet. I got work for you to do. I have a purpose for you. So you gotta get up and walk. The journey is long, but I'll be with you as I am with you now. But remember, you are down, but not out. Life hits hard at times. There will be moments when we will be struck down, but God is always by our side, being our refuge and being our strength, nourishing, nurturing, and sustaining us. As Paul wrote, we are struck down, but never destroyed. In the words of my youth baseball coach, you may be down in the count, but that doesn't mean you are out. In difficult moments, when you are down, when you feel down, we need to retreat, find shelter in God's presence, be watchful, and in silence, let God's gentle whisper revive us and give us a renewed sense of God's purpose for our lives. Church, God is calling us, and He's telling us that we are still in prayer. There is much work we can do. And with God's leading, God's presence, and God's guidance, we will accomplish much for the glory of God and the benefit of God's people. Can you say amen today?
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks, Almighty God, for we know that you are with us. When we are downcast, we know that you are right there beside us, extending your loving arms to bring us up again. Today, O Lord, that we pray that as you strengthen the feeble hands and the knees that give way, you will help us also to go out into the world with this great news that you have shared with us this morning and strengthen those who are weak. Help us to call those who may be down in spirit, call them back to life. Let them know that they are still in place because you have a purpose and a vision and a dream for each of us that you have work for us to do. So Lord, as we go from here, never from your presence, may you inspire us to live the life that you are calling us to live. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. As people who have been fed, reassured, and have found rest in God, let us now go out into the world with a renewed sense of God's call for our lives. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. May God be with you until we meet again. Amen.